So we have this example here, and one thing we see here is we have this thing over here that's happening that we might not like very much. Some people are getting huge net benefits from the provision of the public good, and other people are actually being harmed by the provision of the public good. And, you know, what we might say here is, aha, I know a solution. Instead of making the tax equal on everybody, an $8 equal tax on everybody, let's tax people in proportion to their benefits. And that certainly seems to make sense. Now, the tricky thing here is that we can't directly measure the benefits that people get from something, typically. So we're going to have to basically try to ask them in one way or another, or discover in one way or another, how much they actually value something. And I'm going to set up a little game here using our game theory. And I'm going to think that people don't necessarily always tell the truth when you ask them questions about politics. Or if you ask them, you know, what do you want for dinner, you know, they might not always answer honestly out there. I'm going to reduce this back down to two players, because that's how we know to do game theory here. And we're going to think of Rebecca the role player, and Kathy the column player. And they can each act one of three ways when the public good comes up for discussion. Rebecca can abstain and say, you know what, I don't care. You know, I place zero value on it. She can oppose it and say, you know what, this public good actually harms me on net. So if you're going to implement this, if you're going to put in this street light and it's going to shine in my eyes, I want some kind of compensation. Or, you know, the new street that we put in is going to create traffic in front of my house and I don't like that. Or she can support it. And Kathy has the same options here. And I'm going to assume in this example here that the public good is actually beneficial. And in particular, I'm going to assume it's so beneficial that even if Rebecca pays all the costs of having the public good provided, she's still a net beneficiary. So sort of the status quo here, they each get 10 points. And if Rebecca supports it, but Kathy abstains, then Rebecca has to pay all the taxes to support it, and Kathy doesn't pay anything. And they're both better off, though. In particular, I'm going to say that that produces 6 benefits for Rebecca, net of the tax, and 10 benefits for Kathy, who gets the benefits of the public good but pays none of the tax. The other way around, if Rebecca says, I abstain and Kathy supports, then Rebecca gets benefits of 20, Kathy gets benefits of 16. And if they both support it, then they both split the tax burden equally, and they both get a payoff of 18. If they both oppose it, nothing happens. If one opposes it and one abstains, then the public good isn't provided either. And then finally here, if Rebecca supports it, but Kathy opposes it, then Kathy potentially can get some compensation from Rebecca because, you know, allegedly, according to Kathy, this public good actively harms her due to traffic or whatever. Then, not only does Rebecca have to bear all the cost of providing the public goods, she actually has to pay Kathy compensation of 8. So relative to here, you can see that I've transferred 8 away from Rebecca and towards Kathy. And over here, we have the opposite situation here. Okay, So how's this game going to go ahead and work out? Maybe the easiest way to do this is to think about what would happen if we started at various places in this game matrix. So let's go ahead and suppose that initially, provisionally, we start in this lower right-hand corner. Does either player have an incentive to switch their strategy? Yes. So, in particular, if Rebecca knows that Kathy is going to be supporting, then Rebecca is going to want to move up. Potentially all the way up to oppose, in fact. So, we can talk about what Rebecca's best response is. And Rebecca's best response, if Kathy is supporting it, is to go all the way up here. On the other hand, if Kathy knows that Rebecca is going to support, then Kathy should oppose. So that bottom right-hand corner is not in equilibrium. Okay, what if we end up over here? If we end up over here, then we're going to go ahead and see that, Rebecca is not going to want to stay put. If she moves up here, then she gets 10 instead of 8. And likewise, if we stay over here, Kathy's going to want to switch and get 10 instead of 8. So where does that put us? Potentially, any of these squares up here are a kind of maybe equilibrium. Actually, no, because if we end up over here, then if Rebecca thinks, what do I want to do if I can unilaterally switch? Then Rebecca is going to want to move down here so that she can get 16 instead of 10. And if we start here, then Kathy is going to want to move over that way so that she can get 16 instead of 10. Okay, so what if we're here? What if we start here? Well, again, we're gonna see here that Kathy is going to want to claim that she opposes this, even though she's actually benefiting from it. And likewise, if we start here, Rebecca's going to want to move us there. So essentially, both people are going to claim, no, I don't want it, you pay for it. And if you're going to do it, it's actually going to harm me, so you better give me some extra compensation on the side. And you can see that once we think about the possibility of people acting strategically, and maybe even a little deceptively, that we will not actually get the public good being provided. Now, if there's a high level of trust between these two people, then potentially they would each say something honest, and we could actually solve this problem. But in lots of political situations, a high level of trust is notably lacking. I think we all have evidence of that from our political system. So it's a little bit tricky to think about how our political process would actually get to a situation where we would provide the efficient level of a public good.